talk till we wanna be. We want to be free.
Independence is key to building your legacy. I'm Marcus J, and welcome back to season two of Legacy Media Group Presents Legacy TV. Once again, I'm your host, Marcus J, and this is the first show of our second season here at Comcast and Verizon, and later on YouTube, you'll be able to catch the replays there. I want to thank everybody who joined us in our first season. I want to thank everybody who has been supporting us as we've done everything at Legacy Media Group and Legacy Internet Radio and Legacy TV, and those folks who have supported all of our shows there, including my show, Ain't No Half Steppin' with Marcus J, which airs on Monday nights from 7 p.m. Eastern, basically until we finish. We've got hashtag Brother Sister Shenanigans and Couch Coach Live. We also have a New Balance, I've Got Something to Say. We have the Michael White Show, Doing Time, and several other shows that will be joining us coming up here in the very near future. And it's because you guys continue rocking with us every single week on Legacy Internet Radio. It's the reason why we will continue to roll with you guys, not only there at that branch of our media group, but also right here on Legacy TV. So as we progress throughout tonight's show, I want to take this opportunity to introduce you guys to some fabulous, outstanding guests that I'm looking forward to bringing to you guys. I want to give you guys an opportunity, if you'd like, to call us at 804-915-5202. That's 804-915-5202. To be a part of tonight's discussion. The phone lines are open. They'll be open throughout this hour that we'll be here on Comcast and Verizon for Legacy TV. And so I want to take this opportunity, as I mentioned, to introduce, I've got two fabulous guests with me. I'm going to introduce first, sitting to my immediate right, a dear friend of mine and a sister of mine. We are the founder of Sowing Seeds, Inc., my sister, Andrea Ross. How you doing?
I'm good. How are you doing today?
I'm doing outstanding. And before we even go further, we're going to get the particulars out of the way. You go by Moni?
Yes.
So we're going to call you Moni.
Yes, that's fine.
We're going to call you Moni. All right. And then sitting to your immediate right, is, and I'm just meeting you tonight, and I'm so blessed to be able to do that, our sister, Gail Timberlake. How you doing today?
I'm doing fabulous. Thank you for having me.
I'm doing outstanding. Well, great. Sowing Seeds is an organization, Moni, that you founded recently, and we're going to talk about that. I want to know a little bit about the foundation. We're going to expand more into it on the second part of tonight's show after our first break, which will be later on. But to tease it a little bit, why don't you tell us what Sowing Seeds, Inc. is? Just give it to me briefly, and then we'll talk more about it later in the show.
Sowing Seeds, Inc. is a nonprofit organization dedicated to giving young widow and widowers help and assistance to just encourage them and to help them move forward after they lost a loved one. Right. And it also helps their children that's lost a parent or children that's lost parents.
I see. Okay, well, we're definitely going to expand more on that later on in the show. But that was a very personal organization for you. It's personal because you are a widow yourself.
Yes.
And so are you, Gail. You're also a widow. So I want to kind of talk a little bit about both of you guys' stories so that the folks that are watching at home will understand where Sowing Seeds came from and why it's such an outstanding organization, the work that you all do. So, Moni, I'll start with you. How long have you been a widow?
I've been a widow for 8 years.
8 years. Mm-hmm. So tell me about... Well, first of all, before you do that, tell us about him. What was he like? What kind of man was he?
My late husband, his name was Kermit Ross. He was more of a social butterfly. He, you know, was out there in the community, you know, meeting, greeting with other people. And it was no stranger that he's never met.
Right.
So he was just that all around lovable guy.
Right. Right. So he was someone who was the life of the party, was someone who
pretty much
when you met him, you shook his hand and gave you a big bear hug.
That's right.
Yeah. So I can appreciate that kind of personality. How long were you guys married?
We were married when he passed away. We had married in 2001, so we were married for 8 years, and okay. He passed in 2009.
In 2009, okay. And were you guys dating a long time, high school sweethearts?
Yes, we were high school sweethearts, so we have known each other, you know, forever. So ups, downs, highs, and lows, right. You know, we have been through it.
Yeah, well, high school sweethearts, that's awesome. I can definitely appreciate that. Now, you mentioned that you guys got married in 2001. You guys have any children?
Yes, I have a 11-year-old at the moment. When my late husband passed away, she was 2, almost 3 years old.
Okay, okay. She have any memories? Does she remember her dad?
She has little memories, like him taking her to the store or him taking her to his dad's or, you know, just visit another family, you know, right. Without me. It's like those little memories that she holds on to or memories of her giving her dad a hug or a kiss, right. You know, going to work.
Right, right. Well, those are the memories that, of course, will stay with her, you
yes,
know, for the rest of her life. And I'm definitely glad that she has them. Let's talk about how we lost them.
It was a motorcycle accident, Father's Day weekend, and very unexpectedly, because that evening we were all at a family gathering that Saturday, and it had gotten late, and Kaden, with her being 2, she had gone to sleep. So I just said, I will take her home, you know, since it's getting late, the dew is falling, and it was the summer. So, you know, dew was about to fall. It was like 11 o'clock at night when I left. So he just said, well, I'm not going to be too far behind you, you know, and then I'll, you know, be on. But his twin brother was also there. My late husband has an identical twin brother. He was at the functioning with us. And he said, well, if he's too tired to get on the bike to go home, he can always stay at my house. So I said, okay. So I guess time went on and I never heard anything from him. So I just assumed that, okay, he's at his brother's house. He stayed there.
Right.
So it wasn't until 7 o'clock Sunday morning when I get a knock at the door and I'm thinking it's him. I'm like, okay, he's on his bike. So maybe he's left his house key in his car, because he would normally leave his car at his parents' home. So I just unlock the door and, you know, get on back in the bed. And then I see my mother and other family members coming in the door. And it's like, you know, go ahead and put on some clothes and come on out here. So that was when I got the news.
I see.
Mm-hmm.
So they kind of brought together everybody to kind of...
Right. I had that support system from the beginning.
From the very, very mm-hmm. beginning. That's kind of what I was going to. Wow. So my next question, as far as the aftermath with his passing, was he in some sort of motorcycle? He was in a motorcycle?
Right.
Group?
He was in Cobra One, and he and his twin brother had originally started in the Richmond chapter.
Okay.
They had recently formed the Powhatan chapter not long after his passing.
Okay.
So he was, you know, already in the bike community in the Richmond chapter, but then as time went on, they formed a Powhatan chapter.
Right.
So yes, he was in Cobra One.
Okay. So talk to us about the first few years after his passing. I would imagine that it was pretty difficult for you. You're a relatively new mom with a mm-hmm. toddler, and I'm guessing she's asking a lot of questions and things of that. So
yes.
Let's talk about that.
It was a challenge, and more so difficult, because since my late husband had a twin brother, I was more fearful that our daughter would look at her uncle as her dad from a distance if she would have seen him somewhere.
Right.
So that was a fear that I always had in the back of my mind, but I'm just thankful that when she saw her uncle, she didn't say, is that my dad? It was Uncle Carl, right. You know, when she would see him.
So she never went through the confusion period with
she
that?
She never, even when we were at family gatherings and they both were standing beside each other, both could, like, have their, I could be holding her, both could have their hand out. She would always go to her dad. And I think it was because he interacted differently with her
right.
than how the uncle would interact with her.
Right.
So it's like she knew, even though they looked the exact same.
Right. I'm guessing you can tell the difference at sight as well.
Yes.
Now, what about others? Would I have known the difference?
You may not have, because it's even some family members that still, you know, they would still say, Kermit Carl, you know. they still didn't get them right.
Right.
You know.
Right. You're watching Legacy TV right here on Comcast and Verizon. If you would like to be a part of tonight's discussion, our phone number is 804-915-5202. The first couple of years, as a kind of talked a little bit about, were difficult, were challenging. Let's talk a little bit about the challenges that you had. Did you have support in the first few years after his passing with you? I mean, we talked a little bit about your daughter, but with you?
There was always family support, but there was never any venue that you could go to, say, with your child or take your child to where I lived at.
Right.
You know, so that was one thing that I often was like, you know, do they have any support groups, you know, for young widows like myself with a child?
Right.
You know, and between finding people that were similar to you in age that's dealt with that loss, it's like you felt different, I guess, speaking to other people
right.
who hadn't been through what you were going through, who even understood
right.
what you were going through and what you were feeling.
Right.
So that was a challenge in itself, because it was like, what I'm feeling, is this normal?
Right.
Is this right? Am I going crazy?
Right.
So it's like you always had, you know, those emotions, and then just trying to get back to some type of normalcy,
right.
you know.
And that was actually my next question I was going to ask you. With the time that passed, you know, I haven't lost anyone my age,
mm-hmm.
But I have lost elders, and it's different. I would imagine that is different, and the sense of loss that you feel is something that you don't really ever get past, but mm-hmm. you learn to work around it. At least it had been that way for me with elders. I would guess that it's similar, but I don't know. So my question is, as the years have passed, does it get better? Does it get easier?
It gets easier as time goes on, but yet you still have those overwhelming moments that you would just want to talk to them about, okay, this is going on at the house.
Right.
If he was here, what would he do?
Right.
You know, and just making the decisions on your own
right.
is hard. And especially like when you have a child, it's like, what would he want for her?
Right.
So it's like, you make a decision for yourself on his behalf,
right.
as well as, you know, you're making decisions for your child, thinking right. that, what would he want for her?
Right, right. I can imagine that is definitely challenging, and if I hadn't told you, I'll tell you publicly, condolences definitely to
Thank you,
and the entire family. Let's shift. Let's talk a little bit to you, Ms. Gale. You are also a widow.
Yes, I am.
How long have you been a widow?
4 years.
4 years. Okay. And was his passing due to something medical, or was it sudden?
Yes, it was due to medical, and yes, it was sudden.
Okay.
He died of congestive heart failure.
I see.
And he was diabetic.
Okay.
And was having a lot of health challenges and heart issues. So.
Okay. So when that day came, tell us about that day. Tell us about. Did you have any idea that, you know, his illness was coming to that, or was it just really sudden as it was with our sister Monica?
It was, I realized that he was having so many health issues that if we didn't make some serious changes in diet, etc., that he would not have a long life as we had planned to have. We were married 42 years.
Okay.
And so it was just a regular, normal Sunday, and he was working with my grandson on a tractor.
Okay.
And they were having a great time, and I reminded him that it was a school day the next day, and we needed to get Trey home. So he'd come in, and we had a regular Sunday evening and had retired, and within minutes after laying down to retire for the evening to sleep, he couldn't breathe. He had difficulty breathing and okay. called the rescue squad, and he never made it to the hospital.
I see. And certainly my condolences to you guys as well,
Thank
to you.
You
and your family as well. Talk to me a little bit about the support that you had when you lost your husband. Did you have family support? Did you have community support?
Both. I cannot imagine experiencing loss without having family and community and church, I cannot even wrap my head around not having that support to get you through the just the normal, regular things every day.
Right. You mentioned the grandson. How many children do you actually have?
I have one son.
Okay.
Moni works with him. Yes. And I have one daughter.
Okay.
She's a teacher, and we have five grandchildren.
Five grand. So yes. The grands of it, we have little boys, little girls.
I have all boys, but I'm very fortunate that through foster care, I was able to get a granddaughter foster care.
Awesome.
When we got her, she was a teenager, and I was always threatening to put pink bows in her hair, but she would not let me do that. So.
You know, it's funny, you know, my daughter, hopefully she's watching, she's not one for pink, she doesn't care much for pink, but the irony is, if you know me, I'm a pretty masculine guy who wears black and gray all the time, but I absolutely love pink.
Good.
Pink is probably my second favorite color behind black, so it's pretty funny. Let's talk a little bit about your husband. What kind of guy was he?
Well, I thought perhaps Moni was giving a description of my Jimmy, big bear hugs, and he was quite a mentor to a lot of young men in the community. He was volunteer firefighter, and through that and church, everybody looked to Jimmy for how to make it through daily experiences and tough times, and also how to have a good time. He's just a really loved. Our community grieved with me.
Right. 42 years. How did you guys meet?
We were high school sweethearts. Also. Oh my gosh, honey. Oh wow.
High school sweethearts, married 42 years. That is absolutely awesome. One other thing that I wanted to ask you about that we learned a little while ago when we were doing a little show prep, that you're an author.
I am.
Talk to us about that. I want to sell some books today.
Okay.
We will sell some books.
Well, I have to say that I'm a woman of faith.
Okay.
And found myself in trouble on the James River one day. I participate in a historical reenactment called the James River Bateau Festival.
Okay.
And I'm on the Lady Slipper boat. It's all female crew. And we got hung up on a dam that was just below the surface of the water. And we were in trouble. We were going to sink, and we were out of the boat trying to move the boat off the dam. And yeah. Anyway, long story short, I was either going to get sucked under that boat or crushed between the boat and the dam. And a younger crew had stopped to help us, and one of those young men just pulled me from between the two. And after that happened, I said, "Golly, I could have died." And God might as well have tapped me on the shoulder and said, "You better write this down." I said, "I will." And so now I write children's books, and I have an entire series, the Lady Slipper series of children's books. And I've also written one about my missionary work in Tanzania called Niangusi Brought a Monkey to Church.
Wow.
Wonderful book.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So how can we get the books?
Well, you can get them on Amazon, and you can certainly contact me to get the books. They were for sale at our local drugstore, which was family-owned and now has become CVS. But you can get them on Amazon.
Well, we definitely want to make sure that, so if you're watching us tonight, you make sure that you get these books and you help support our sister here. We're going to sell some books tonight. 804-915-5202 is the number to dial if you'd like to speak with our sister Moni and our sister Gail. You guys kind of tipped your hand a little bit to what my next question was as we kind of move towards the latter stages of this particular segment. I was going to ask you how you guys met, but you work with her son. So let's talk about that. I don't know if that's got anything to do with anything.
I taught Moni in high school.
Are you serious?
And I taught her husband.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, we got to talk about that. We got to talk about that. So what kind of student was she?
Moni was,
you be quiet.
Moni was compassionate and kind, and she was a good student.
Yeah.
I just was drawn to Moni because she was so compassionate and kind and such fun. I mean, she had a smile and sense of humor too. She's quiet most of the time, but good sense of humor.
I see the suspicion that there's certain things you could rile her up. We just got to figure out what they are. Yeah. Most of us are like that. So you were a teacher. What grade level?
8th grade through 12th grade when Moni was in school.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And when the school, we built a new school, now it's 9th grade through 12th.
Okay, okay. So you taught both of them in school. Now, how did you guys reconnect as you have become an adult, Moni? How did you guys connect?
Well, because her son is the commissioner, and I work for the Commissioner of Revenue.
Okay.
It's like we were always still connected.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes. Even throughout the years, because I would always see her coming in the office and, okay. you know, all of that.
Never really lost
connection. We never really lost connection.
No. And through church. I'd see her things that, community things
right.
at church.
How awesome is it to have a connect with a teacher that you liked when you were younger? You know, it's pretty neat. I've got two teachers that as an adult I still keep in contact with. My 8th grade teacher is a man by the name of Mr. Atkins, and I'll tell you a really brief story about Mr. Atkins. I was in the 8th grade. I was the the manager of the basketball team, and I had a project that I was supposed to do, and I was kind of lazy with it, didn't want to do it. And he kept telling me, you need to do it, you need to do it. If you don't do it, you need to do it. And I didn't do it. And by the time it was passed, he told me, he said, your position as the manager of the basketball team is now defunct. I had never heard that word before. Did not know what it meant. And me and my 13-year-old arrogant mind, I thought it was something cool. I thought he was telling me I did something. It was defunct. All right, cool. It's defunct. And, you know, he says, no, that means it's over. That means you're no longer on the team. And of course, I was very, very upset. And this was at the end of the week, and I scrambled home to do the report, you know, whatever it was, project, whatever it was I had to do. Turned it in Monday, which should have been done before. But defunct means that's it. It doesn't mean that you get to go back and make it right. And I was really upset with him, but I always understood that lesson. When you have a responsibility, something that you know that you're supposed to do, it's not okay to skirt the responsibility. You have to make sure that you do it. And so that was a lesson that I learned from Mr. Atkins. And, you know, I had lost contact with him for many years, but through the wonders of Facebook, like many of us who have reconnected with, you know, old friends and family members, and in this case, an old teacher. And so I was definitely glad to make acquaintances with him. And he was just tickled to death that I actually want to talk to him. So, you know, I know a lot of teachers, you guys meet a lot of children. And you come across different personalities, and you may connect with some, and you may not. But I felt like that was a conversation. And I told him that. He didn't even remember. He didn't even remember. And then, of course, I've got a high school guidance counselor who I kept up with, who I talk to this day for wisdom and guidance and things of that sort. So it's a fabulous thing, and I love to see you guys working together with sowing seeds, and the fact that you guys have had an opportunity to spend time over the years.
Yes.
That's really, really pretty cool. So we're going to move towards a break. And when we come back, we're going to take some time and talk about Sowing Seeds, Inc. We want to talk about what the company is, what their mission is, and how they can help those of us in the community who may need some guidance. Phone lines are going to be open, 804-915-5202. You're watching Legacy TV here on Comcast and Verizon. I'm Marcus J. We're into a break. We'll be back in a few minutes.
Yeah. family, check this out. Legacy Internet Radio, the dopest thing on the internet right now. You might want to check us out. You might want to come rock with us because we got a show for everybody. We got something for the ladies enjoying body radio with our girl Ashley and Big Bro Joe. We got something on Sundays, Twilight After Dark, for those that are sexually inclined and want to figure out how to make your partner happy. Check them out with Bella, W Balls, and Stacey. Then you can come check out us Saturdays, 2:30 to 4:30. I got something to say. Because it's a show for everybody. They got something to say. We all got something to say, but you ain't got nowhere to say it. You can come here and check us out on Legacy Internet Radio. But then, flagship show on the station, ain't no half-step, Brother Marcus J. You don't know what you got. You don't know what you got. Check them out. Mondays, 7 to 9, ain't no half-step. Marcus J, real. Politics, economy, the real, real. He's going to get you right. Check them out.
Hey, what's going on, man? James Harris. I'm here for United Black Business Group, LLC. That's a nonprofit that you might have heard about. I definitely just want to thank Legacy Internet Radio, my man Marcus, for having us come through. Seems like a long time, man, but I remember probably a year or so ago we was here, and it looked pretty different, but I guess you're advancing like we're trying to advance. So United Black Business Group, LLC, is a local nonprofit here. We're trying to do four key things. One of those key things is get a black-owned bank in the city. Second is agriculture. We're trying to get gardens throughout the city. Thirdly, real estate, man. We want commercial, residential, and stuff like that. So that's what we're pushing. Then the fourth thing is education. Education is the key. So not just from an academic standpoint, but financial literacy, first aid, CPR, just different things that we can do to enhance our community. So we definitely want to keep grinding, man, keep grinding like legacy. We want to grow our legacy as well. So you guys got a lot of momentum here at Legacy, so we definitely want that same momentum for our nonprofit. If you want to assist us, man, you can assist us at United Black Business Group LLC. That's on Facebook. Website is unitedbbg.org, or you can Gmail us, unitedbbg@gmail.com. Definitely appreciate you, Marcus, man. I'm liking this new look, man. It looks more spacious. Everything look good. You got multiple microphones now. You're doing good, man. I definitely appreciate your time, man. Thanks a lot.
Independence is key to building your legacy. Legacy Internet Radio is the internet radio station that we founded on March 4th, 2013. On that day, we started our internet radio station in Big Rube's kitchen. Prior to that, it was three guys doing an internet radio show on another radio station. And we realized and knew that we had a bigger, stronger, more prominent calling. So we founded Legacy Internet Radio, which is now a part of Legacy Media Group, along with Legacy TV, which you're watching right now. Socially conscious talk and TV that's entertaining with a dash of humor. And we appreciate everybody who's a part of Legacy Media Group, Legacy Internet Radio, and Legacy TV. Started off with three, and now we've got a team of over 30 people helping us produce our programming 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, on internet radio, as well as on television. We appreciate the love and support. Independence is key to building your legacy. Legacy Media Group, Legacy Internet Radio, and Legacy TV. Thank you. Peace.
Give me one more.
Hey, yours truly, Ty Cool here, y'all from Great Soul Radio. And just stopping by, give you a little bit of insight Legacy Internet Radio and what these guys are about. Plenty of talk radio, plenty of excitement, plenty of entertainment. Flagship show, Ain't No Half Step with Marcus J. Great show, great insight, great personality, and a lot of great energy. Now, how do I know Marcus? Let's just say we met in another room and it just kind of spilled over into our radio lives. And to see where this product has come from at its inception to where it is right now,
what can one say? It's beautiful, it's enhancing, and it's something that's very refreshing, something that's very much needed. And if nothing else, y'all, whatever you do, keep going. Keep going. Because I was told, where there may be some darkness somewhere, there's some light where somebody's trying to find it. So where we are in our daily walk, let's continue to provide that light. Let's continue to be that beacon of light. And Legacy Internet, yeah, Legacy Internet Radio, the whole brain behind it, hey, what more can we say, y'all? Independence is still the key to building your legacy. Yo, Shooty Taiku, one love.
And we're back. Thank you for continuing to watch our show, season 2 premiere show, first episode of Legacy Media Group Presents Legacy TV. I am your host, Marcus J. And thank you again for watching us here tonight on Comcast and Verizon, and of course later replay on YouTube and on legacyinternetradio.com on Legacy TV. I'm here with my guests, my special guests, our sister Moni and our sister Gail, and we were talking to them about sowing seeds. We're talking to them about their experience as widows, which is what led us to sowing seeds. So when we led off the show, Moni, we asked, what is sowing seeds? And I wanted to kind of go into the whole description of you guys' experiences as widows to kind of set the tone for what sowing seeds is. So now we're at a point where it's set. I want to spend some time actually talking about your nonprofit. So tell us one more time, what exactly is sowing seeds? Similar to how you did before, but let's expand on a little bit more in the segment.
Okay. Sowing Seeds is a nonprofit organization dedicated to assisting young widowers with and without children to help them move forward after they've lost a loved one. So if this widow is facing hardships, if this widow does not have the money for counseling, if the widow just needs support financially to help with bills, it can even be the burial cost of that loved one. If we have it, we want to be able to help them.
Right. What was the impetus to make you found this? You know, I'm guessing it was your experience losing your husband, but let's talk a little bit more about specifically what led you down that path.
It was my experience, and even with me being a young widow, I had met others that were in similar situations such as myself, but did not have what my late husband had left me. Even though I don't have much, but I have something.
Right.
And then I think of these widows who don't have anything. They did not have a savings. They did not have life insurance. They did not have anything financially that they could fall back on to say, I'm going to be okay, at least for the next few years.
Right.
It's some that can't say that they're going to be okay in the next week to 2 weeks after they bury their loved one because their husband was the financial breadwinner. But yet, they did not have that life insurance plan. They did not have that emergency savings fund to be able to put their loved one to rest or to help them carry on the burden that, you know, that they have to do everything alone.
Right. Gail, jump in here. Tell me your thoughts on sowing seeds.
I'm so proud of what Moni has done, just from the get-go, what she's done. There's definitely the need. Young widows, like she says, I wouldn't have had that problem being my age and being well established. But for a young woman with a young child, I'm just real proud of the ways that she has worked toward helping and having hope.
Right. How, I understand you're a board member.
Yes.
What kind of duties do you have? Like, what do you do?
I'm still learning. I just look to Moni to tell me what I need to do and when I need to do it, and then I follow suit.
Right.
We've reversed our roles. she's teaching me now what to do and how to do it. She asked me to serve on the board, and I said, Moni, I'm so involved in so many things in the community. As long as you don't give me really hard stuff to do, just tell me what to do, and I will do it.
How come I know that's exactly how that conversation went? I have no doubt that's exactly how that conversation went. Well, let's talk about those duties. I mean, what do you need?
How can you be supported? What do you need from the community? Let's talk about that, Moni.
Just to sow a seed isn't just financial. If you know of someone that's going through something, just being that encourager, just being that person that they can go to be, just to be themselves and not feel like they have to put on a mask to be something that they're not.
Right.
And if a person is coming to you that's going through something, keep whatever they want to discuss between you and them and not to discuss it amongst other people.
Right. That's
because you have a lot of people that are going through something, but they're afraid to open up because you have people that will say, I'm here for you, but yet they'll be going to tell the next person, you know, this person is going through this, you know. Just keep that between you and them. If they want to share with other people, let them share with other people.
Right.
But, you know, you just keep that between you and them so they can feel the need to be able to trust you and to be able to come to you.
Right, right. You had your launch for Sowing Seeds just a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that. I was there. I was honored to be there to support you. Tell us about the run-up to that, because I remember seeing you a few times and I saw the excitement. I see the smile on your face right now just as you... thinking about it. Talk to us.
I was excited but nervous at the same time because it was like that day, it felt like I was getting married again. I was like, oh my gosh, why do I feel so nervous? Yeah. Like, you know, I don't know if I should be doing this or not, but I figured, you know, this is my purpose because God has put people in my path that have made this journey a little bit more easier.
Right. So the launch was a success, I'm guessing.
Yes, it was a success.
Yeah. So tell us about going forward, how you can be supported in sowing seeds so that you have the resources to be able to support the widows and children going forward. So what do you need?
Of course, any donation, small, large, will be beneficial because, like I said, I want to be able to help these widowers that may need help burying their loved one.
Right.
We all know the costs just to bury loved ones can range between $5,000 up to $20,000 and $30,000.
Right.
No one has that, you know,
right.
Sometimes in a savings. And like I said, if you don't have that insurance policy or backup savings, you're just, it's a cheaper version to put their loved one to rest, and it's a way that they may not want to, but it's like they want something nice, but not just anything.
Right. So what happens, I mean, when it's not there? You know, what do they do? Have you experienced what happens in that case?
I'm really not sure if they may hold bodies for a certain amount of time or what other funeral homes do. That's one thing that I do want to find out in case I ever run across someone in that situation to say, what can they do, you know, in order to still lay their loved one to rest and not have to keep this in the back of their mind to say, I don't have this money, or I don't have the means that this funeral home wants me to have in order to put this loved one to rest.
So how do folks find out about sowing seeds that may need the services? For example, I'm just going to create a generic situation and then you tell me how you would actually play into it. So, a person loses their life through whatever means they lose their life. You now have a widow, and the widow doesn't know what to do. How, first of all, do they find out about you guys? And then take me step by step how you would seek to support them.
Okay. I can be found on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter at Sowing Seeds 804. And I can also be found online, and the website is www.tusoseeds.org, and I can also be reached through email, and the email address is tusoseeds@gmail.com.
Have you had any opportunities to go through it just yet?
Not with an actual widow, but I have connected with other people that's lost significant others.
Right.
Just to support them, just to let them know that, you know, you're not alone.
Right.
You know, there's someone that is supporting you and backing you with whatever your need may be.
Right. I can imagine that initial meeting is challenging, is shocking.
Mm-hmm.
What's it like for you? Does it make you kind of relive what you've been through, supporting someone that's in the right now, those raw emotions?
It's, I mean, you feel, you just can relate to their pain. when you hear about someone else that's going through something or someone that's lost a husband, you know, at a young age or even at an older age.
Right.
You know, it's like, oh man, you know, especially when it's unexpected.
Right.
You know, it's like, oh my gosh, how can I help them? You know, what can I do? So, you know, I would just, you know, reach out to them to say, I'm here if you need anything, you can contact me with this, that, and the other. And if there is people that will contact me to say, what do I do? You know, try to help them with seeing how the type of plans that their late employers had,
right,
as far as did they have life insurance, right, did they have any other secondary retirement accounts to help them be able to transfer that information from their late husband's name to their name.
Right.
You know, letting them know about, let's see, say their vehicles. If the late husband had vehicles just in his name, you know, she would need to, she or he would need to transfer that information to their name. You know, it's like a ton of things that you don't think about when you are, when you're in that moment of trying to make arrangements. You don't think about that stuff. So this is just to help them to say, be sure you've done this, be sure you've done that. And I want to create like a checkoff list, you know, for widowers to say, this, you know, double check on this, double check on that. And a lot of widowers also, they don't think to, you know, even contact, say, DMV, you know, it's changing the addresses, you know, contacting insurance companies, doctors, credit cards, lend holders that their late significant other had to say, I need to close this account, you know.
Right. You know, as you're talking here, that's overwhelming for me, and I'm not in a moment of loss.
Right.
And to hear you talk about call the insurance company, call DMV, call a doctor's office, call this one and call that one. As I'm sitting, when you said the checklist, I'm just sitting there thinking, as a person that's already dealing with so much, because the unfortunate reality is all of those people, they may not have the compassion that's necessary to be able to deal with someone that's grieving. So they ain't gonna, like if it's a credit card that doesn't get paid, they're not gonna care that something happened. You know, and I feel even silly saying it, but they won't feel silly still wanting their money.
Right.
And so with you guys being in a position to support someone, even on the, I won't say lowest level, but on the most basic of don't forget to do this, don't forget to do that. Like, who thinks of that stuff? Like, who thinks of that stuff? And it's just...
Especially when you're grieving.
Right.
Because you are so deeply unaware so many days. You're just trying to make it through the days, and you're not thinking of every little detail, even Social Security.
Yes.
And they don't always tell you everything. I'm still in a battle with Social Security over the death benefit.
Wow. Four years later.
Yeah.
Wow.
I went to apply, and they said, oh, you only had 2 years to do that. And I said, I beg your pardon? Nobody told me I had 2 years to do that. And I was too late. So I appealed it. And they don't want to hear that. And I had a hearing and took everything about grieving. I'm like, you can't put a limit on how long I grieve.
Right.
And books say, you know, I'm young enough still to know, but an older lady who may not have...
Right.
All their wits about them, right, if I could use that expression.
Sure, we understand that.
They're not thinking about details like you're thinking of, and even, or time limits.
And even the younger, like my age with a child, I wouldn't have thought to go to Social Security Administration on my child's behalf if someone didn't tell me.
So you would be eligible.
I'm not eligible, but my child is.
Correct.
Wow.
Yeah, and another thing too for sowing seeds, it's like even though we're young and widowed, we don't get any other assistance, say through social services, because we're above the poverty level. You know, so it's like we have a mortgage, we have car, we have insurance, we have all this stuff to pay now from one paycheck. So that was another thing that I thought of was starting this nonprofit. Like, how can someone like myself who didn't have what I have make it, yet with no other help that's out there for them?
Right.
You know, so it's like one paycheck can really make or either break you if you don't have, you know, that extra support and that help.
Right. You know, I'm sitting here and I'm overwhelmed. Again, as I mentioned before, 804 915-5202. I'm overwhelmed just hearing it as someone who is speaking with you all, and I think about sowing seeds, and there's a three-word tagline that goes with it. Tell us what that three words is.
That is helping, healing, and hoping.
Talk to us about how you came up with that.
I just thought about, you know, the people that you want to help, you know, and that needs the help. So, you know, when I thought of sowing seeds, you can sow seeds in multiple ways, you know, so I want to help these people. You know, as far as the hoping, I want them to be able to hope, you know, have hope for the future and not to give up, to say that, you know, I can make this. This may have happened, but it's not going to tear me down to the point where I can't continue to go on.
Right.
So, you know, we want to give them hope to let them know that there is hope in the future. And the healing will come after we do the helping.
Right.
You know, so after we do help, you know, some of them, maybe that can start their healing process to say, okay, I can do this. This is not going to be as bad as I think it's going to be.
Right.
Because I have this help. I have this support system, you know, along this journey.
Right. About, I don't know, maybe 13, 14 years ago, I had a good friend of mine. She took ill and she passed away.
Mm-hmm.
And I always was so sad about that. She was a couple of years younger than what I am. And she just was someone that got ill and she passed away. And she had a husband and two young boys. And, you know, I didn't keep in touch with her husband and boys,
mm-hmm.
Unfortunately. But I've always thought about them.
Right.
Because like most young mothers and young parents, male or female, she just loved her boys. She loved her boys. She loved her family. And I always thought about her husband. So my question is sowing seeds for widows, or is there help for widowers?
It's both. You know, it can be a man that's lost a wife. It can be a mother that's lost a husband. And it's for also children that may have lost both parents. And I also think about children that, you know, have lost this parent, but yet is in the process of wanting to go to college. You know, if I had the funding that can help them with tuition, books, I want to be able to help that child that's lost a parent.
Right.
You know, they don't have that extra, you know, financial support to help them in that area.
Right.
I want to be able to help them, you know, with that too, because it's tough on a single parent trying to still continue to pay the bills, yet put a child through college and
right.
help them with fees, books, right. tuition.
Right. Right. We spent a lot of time, and rightfully so, talking with Moni and Gail about your experiences as widows, but we haven't talked a lot about the children.
Mm-hmm.
I want to talk a little bit about the children and the challenges. Obviously, Gail, your children were adults when they lost their dad. Do you guys see how sowing seeds would be able to help adult children? And obviously, you know, young children, and we'll come back to that.
Mm-hmm.
We'll come back to that in a minute. But is there any way that you can support adult children, or would it be similar to how you would support the spouse if they were adults?
I haven't experienced, you know, an older child, because I just have the young one.
Right.
But I mean, if they need that support, or just say counseling, or just someone to talk to, yeah,
right.
we would, you know, help them, because
right.
we've been through it and we all have lost someone,
right.
even if it wasn't a spouse, but someone that's close to them.
Right.
You know, that they just want to talk more, you know.
Well, and even though you may not have had someone reach out for help,
mm-hmm.
you had to watch and witness, you know, Jamie going back to work,
right.
and the challenge
that's
is
your son.
That's
mm-hmm.
my son.
Okay.
We're a pretty tight family, and like mm-hmm. I say, the entire community grieved, but they're in a lot of pain.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the grandchildren, like
yeah.
My oldest grandson, he was very, very close to his granddad. His mission in life is to be just like his poppy.
Yeah, that's what he called him.
That's what he called him. And he's doing a real good
yes,
job so
yes.
far, following right in his footsteps.
Yeah, how old is he, if you don't mind me asking?
He's 14.
He's 14. Is he the child that was with him?
Yes.
He was. I had a feeling
yes.
that he, I had
yeah.
a feeling that he was. And my daughter is also 14, and I was 14 when I lost my poppy, my granddad, and
mm-hmm.
I would have loved to have something like this, because
mm-hmm.
I never really grieved until I got older. because when you're young, a lot of times you don't understand what you're supposed to be feeling. Right. You know, so you don't know what to say, you don't know what to do. You know, of the four grandparents that I had, I lost one when I was three, one when I was 14. Those were my grandfathers. And then my grandmother, paternal, I lost when I was 17. I remember telling her in the hospital that I had just gotten my driver's license. And, you know, she was in the hospital. It was one of those hospital trips. You knew she wasn't coming home. Even as a 17-year-old, I knew she wasn't coming home. But I remember telling her, I said, can't wait till you get out so I get to drive you around. Because she never drove. She was the lady that never drove. So I couldn't wait to drive around. And those three hurt. You know, they hurt. My grandfather, when I was 14, he hurt because he liked baseball. And I love baseball. We used to sit and watch games. And he promised to take me. Never got around to it. But it was my last grandparent, my Nana, that really broke me. I was broken for a couple of years. And so that's the reason why I asked if there was support for adults. I'm fortunate enough to have both of my parents still with me. But I always felt like my daughter, who was born in May 2003, and I lost my grandmother in July of 2003. So I always felt like the universe wasn't set up for me to have both of them. You know, so the closeness that I have with my daughter, I would guess is something in there tied into it. So like I said, I would have loved something like this, because you lean on your family and your family is great, but sometimes family is a little too close to the situation because they're dealing with their own grief.
Right.
And they're feeling it just like you are. And so if you have someone on the outside, that's the reason why I'm just so proud of you and so happy that you've taken your grief and you've spun it into an avenue of service and you're giving back. And the whole point of us living and sharing this time together, living, is to serve each other.
That's right.
Because if you're not serving anybody, if you're not giving back to people, then what you doing here? If you just taking, that's all we're doing. You taking, you know. So I just love that. So let's talk a little bit about the children again as we we're getting close towards the end of our conversation. So I wanna just take the last few minutes that we have and talk a little bit about how you serve the children. I know we talked about financially. Is there any way to serve them in the way that I would have needed emotionally? Because I can tell you, I didn't get that.
Right.
And that's not a shot at anybody who was there with me. Like I said, everybody's going through their own stuff. Is there any services to serve them that way?
Let's see. For the young kids, of course, you can't get too in detail because they don't think how we think.
Right.
So it's like, you know, how I would talk to you or talk to Miss Timberlake, they may not understand that. So you just have to try to reach them at their level, you know, to see what they're going to love on them, you know, and just see how they're feeling.
Right.
You know, keep that communication open to say, you know, how are you feeling? Or if they come to you about saying, you know, I miss or I wish, you could say it's okay to miss and to wish, but, you know, your loved one wouldn't want you to stay into this situation forever to be sad. You know, they want you to be happy.
Right.
You know, you have to encourage them. But if their deep is like that grief, then we would, you know, try to resource them with a counselor, you know, someone that is on a professional level that can help them.
Right.
It also helps to give them opportunities to release that grief. For example, on certain anniversaries, make sure that you're providing that opportunity. Example, Trey, the oldest grandson, again, he and his dad made a cross. And the first anniversary of Poppy's death, we all had candles and we put them on and put it out across the pond and sent our wishes up, you know, our good thinking and our love up to Poppy and thankful that there was still light in our lives and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah. I want to take this opportunity, ladies, as we move towards the close of our first episode of season two of Legacy TV here on Comcast and Verizon. I want to give you guys an opportunity to kind of say your final thing before I close this out. Gail, I want you to start first. And if you want to mention about the books again, because like I told you, we're going to sell some books today. We're going to sell some books today. So just any final thoughts?
Well, my final thought, if you're reminding me of books, is that there are other avenues that you can pour yourself into that also help you deal with the grief and what's going on in your life. And for me, it's become writing, and it's an awesome opportunity to find another part of yourself you really didn't know was there.
Right. Mm-hmm. I can imagine.
So find ways to heal.
And occupy yeah. your
time. And count on your community and mm-hmm. those your support.
Right.
But find ways to heal.
I appreciate that. Moni, final words real quick?
Final words, I appreciate you inviting me.
Absolutely.
I do appreciate that. And just to encourage people not to give up, you know, and don't think that because this has happened that it is the end when it's not the end.
Right.
It's just a new chapter that you just haven't yet begun.
Right. Well, I want to take this opportunity to thank our guests, our sister, our new sister Gail, and our sister Moni, who have joined us today on Legacy TV here on Comcast and Verizon. I am Marcus J. You can find me and our crew at www.legacyinternetradio.com for replays of this show and all of our season one shows. You can find them there on our website as well as on YouTube to find me specifically every single Monday night live from the den of Legacy Internet Radio, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I host the flagship show. It's called Ain't No Half Steppin' with Marcus J., which is socially conscious talk that's entertaining with a dash of humor. Independence is key to building your legacy. I'm Marcus J. This has been Legacy TV. We'll see you guys next week.
Tell me, why can't we be what we want?